Hey folks, it's Ray at DCRainmaker.com here, and today I'm going to walk through the behind-the-scenes aspect of running an indoor triathlon on Zwift, which is pretty crazy. It's really the first time we've seen this done in any sort of big production kind of way, and it was yesterday in Rotterdam with the Super League Triathlon Series for the SLT Arena Games, which is their indoor version of the normal outdoor super sprint triathlon type series. And so I went down to Rotterdam, which isn't too far from here in Amsterdam, to check this out and watch them do the swim in a pool, but then do the bike and the run on the pool deck in Zwift virtually, and then repeat the entire thing three times. But the production side of it is all designed for pro triathletes and really designed to fit in like a 40-ish to 45 minute kind of time frame so that it broadcasts well into TV. So in this case, there are three stages, and each stage consists of a 200 meter swim followed by a 4 kilometer bike followed by a 1 kilometer run. But then you repeat the whole thing and then you switch the order each time you repeat it. So the first time was swim, bike, run. The second time was bike, run, swim. And the third time was run, swim, bike, which leads to funny moments like almost watching one of the women jump in the pool with their running shoes on because they're not used to like mentally doing it in that particular order. It's a crazy interesting thing to watch. You can actually watch the full 2 hour long broadcast. I think it was broadcast to like nearly 100 countries around the world yesterday on the YouTube page. So if you have a chance, I did that this morning. Even though I was there yesterday watching it in person, I watched it back this morning online, and I'd say it was probably better online than it was in person, like the broadcast side, because you could see all the races much more clearly than in person. So you can do that. I'll link to that somewhere on the screen here. It's pretty interesting to watch. But I want to talk about the tech. I want to talk about behind the scenes, all the things and how it works. And I said, I've got my notes here. My notes is actually my post that I just finished writing, so you can check that out. But there's a lot of really interesting tidbits that came out of this just from being there in person that I thought were pretty interesting. So the pool, it's a pool. It's a hole in the ground filled with water. There was no real tech there. They swam the 200 meters, and at the end of it, they pressed a button. And when they got to that point where they pressed the button, that meant that their swim was done, and they can go on to whatever the next segment was, assuming there was another segment to do. So in this case, if you look at the first round, they go from there, they run over to their bikes. Their bikes are already set up on Tacx NEO 2T trainers. Now, in this case, Garmin and Tacx, Garmin now owns Tacx, were sponsoring the event or a portion of the event. In talking to the organizers, though, for them, the NEO 2T was useful because there's no calibration allowed or required, and both of those are useful. It's useful to not require it from like a logistics standpoint, but it's useful not to allow it because that means people can't dork with their calibration values and skew the results. So that worked out pretty well. Tacx actually had some of their engineers and support folks there because it was only like a 20-minute drive from Tacx headquarters to Rotterdam, so it was pretty quick, and so they had the people there on site basically as like glorified bike mechanics. So that was kind of neat, swapping out cassettes and stuff like that on trainers for different speed bikes. The NEO 2Ts are then connected via Bluetooth Smart to iPad Pros up on the pool deck. And those were like in these little iPad holder things in front of each athlete. And then that's how they got their power data into Zwift. Okay, and a quick note, if you're finding this video interesting or useful or something like that, simply whack that like button bottom right now. It really helps out this video and the channel quite a bit. Now this is where things get really interesting. So first you say to yourself, it's just Zwift. And it is, it's just Zwift. Virtually everything you saw in this event, you could do in your backyard garage setup if you had like a swimming pool there, the way they did this. There was no special sauce here. Like this wasn't like the virtual Tour de France where there was a lot of special sauce behind the scenes. While Zwift was absolutely involved in the production of this event, in terms of how Zwift operated, it was super basic. So each athlete, they had 10 athletes, 10 women and 10 men that were pro athletes doing this. Each athlete actually had two avatars, two user profiles, one on the bike side of it and one on the run side of it. No athlete was using their normal user profile in Zwift, so they don't like get credit, which kind of sucks for this. So they had their own unique avatar. Each avatar matched the color of their tri-kit, their race, you know, uniform effectively. So the race organizer here actually went ahead and provided each and every one of these 20 pro athletes, the 10 women and 10 men, with a tri-suit that matched their in-game Zwift avatar, and all their sponsors were on it as well. And so the athletes had up until 5 days before the event to get their sponsors to the Super League Triathlon Series so they could put it on the jerseys and get the jerseys. It's pretty crazy logistics. But then on Zwift, the way this works is that they created events. So they created an event at 13:06 or 1:06 p.m. to start for the bike. So while the athletes were off swimming, the bike race started, and that was sitting there waiting them on trainers. So the athletes then run out of the swim and then start the race. but the race has already started and the bikes are just sitting there waiting in the race corral. Just like if you missed a Zwift start, your bike is still just, you know, you're in the corral waiting sort of thing. Same concept there. And then you apply that to the run. They run over to the treadmills that are, you know, 25 meters away, and they have their second Zwift avatar waiting there on the run in a corral that's waiting to go. Now, first that sounds like, okay, no big deal, but here's the catch. They have to do that 3 times. And if you know anything about Zwift racing, you know that Zwift races start at a very set time. Whatever that time is, they start at that time. So in this case, the race was set to start at 1:06 p.m. The next one was set to start, I think, at 1:20 p.m. And so on down the list. If for some reason there was a delay in the arena, the venue, that would have broken everything. And that, and talking to the organizers, that was their biggest nightmare, is that there was some sort of external delay that caused things to delay the broadcast. That would be bad. But the biggest bad thing was that these races were like set to go off shotgun style at very specific times. And once the race were to go off with the avatars involved, like, you couldn't go back. You couldn't step back and press an undo button. The whole thing, the house of cards, would have fallen. And while Zwift was involved, like, it would have been really tough logistically, on air, live, broadcasting to, you know, 100 countries to fix this problem in a expeditious sort of way. Now, for the run, they were using self-powered treadmills, which means that you have to provide the power for the treadmill to spin up. So unlike a traditional treadmill where you press a button, boop, 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 and it goes to whatever speed you set, in this case, you have to provide this resistance to overcome and get these plates moving. If you've never run on one of these curved sort of treadmills, they're interesting. Personally, I think they're hot piles of garbage, but some people like them, and that's cool if you like them. And so it's a very different experience to run on. And as some of these athletes found this out the hard way, because there's a lot more resistance to overcome. They definitely favor a heavier or taller runner than they do a shorter runner. So those treadmills can actually broadcast to Zwift directly the speed and thus your pace. But the organizer didn't find them that accurate. Also, as you probably guessed by this point, they're not sponsored by the Assualt Fitness Air Runners or Assualt Fitness Company. They actually bought all these treadmills. And then, in fact, they bought and assembled all these treadmills Thursday night before the event in Rotterdam, which, if you've ever assembled a treadmill, you know that's a miserable experience as well. So in order to overcome the inaccuracy issues, they put NPE Runn treadmill sensors on them. And I've reviewed these in the past. It's an awesome little sensor you put in your treadmill, and then it basically measures the exact speed of the treadmill. And it's a great way to, like, normalize against foot pods and stuff like that. And so in this case, it was perfect because it can normalize against all 10 of the different athletes. In fact, they even noted they went to the trouble of ensuring that the stickers that you place for the NPE Runn were in the exact same planks, in the exact same spot in each plank for every single treadmill. Even the treadmill heights, they measured to ensure that the rear of the treadmill was level at the exact same height for every single athlete, so it was all as equal as could possibly be. Now again, just like with the bike, that broadcast on Bluetooth Smart from the NPE Runn up to the iPad Pros, and then from the iPad Pros, just like any other Zwift, into the Zwift race competition. Now around this point, I asked them, like, how many connectivity issues have you had? Like, this just seems like a whole lot of mental pain to operate. And they said, surprisingly, not that many. They had started testing this 2 days prior with age group athletes, and then into even the morning prior to the event, where they were doing dry runs with age group athletes. And they had a couple of initial connectivity issues on the treadmill side, but they eventually solved some of that stuff. And they didn't have any that I saw in the race, for the pros anyways. So, but I did ask them, like, would wired connectivity have solved this, solved or made your life easier? And to my surprise, they said, not really, at least not in the way that you would think. They said the main issue they had with wireless connectivity was not dropouts, but that if there was some sort of connectivity issue or some issue with the trainer or the iPad where they had to restart one of those two, that meant that that Tacx NEO or that run for the treadmill sensor could be grabbed by another device, and that would block out the connection to pair to it. So that was really the only issue, was that, you know, if you had to go do some troubleshooting, you could sort of lock yourself out from that trainer, where a wired connection may have solved that down the road. But right now, there's no wired connection options for Zwift, so it's sort of a moot point. Now, it's worth talking about the broadcast side of this, because I find that fascinating. Like, the fact that this whole event was broadcast to probably near 100 countries worldwide. Once you account for some of the things like in Africa, for example, one provider there covers nearly 50 countries. So it's probably about 100 countries as a broadcast live plus the internet. And they had broadcast crews everywhere. So to go back to my cheat sheet here of things I've written down, in Rotterdam where it was held, they had the camera crews. And that was a local production crew from the Netherlands due to COVID restrictions that they had there running three different remote trucks, the same as you would have for like a football game or a basketball game or a baseball game or whatever the case may be, was outside the swimming facility there, including a satellite upload truck. Then in London, they had the production crew from a direction standpoint, a director standpoint. So that was the crew that decided what cameras were going and what cuts to make and all that kind of stuff live. In Edinburgh is Zwift's production headquarters, and that's where they were feeding the game feed. So the run and the cycle side of it was pulling from there into London. Then in Sydney was the commentators. So Chris McCormick or Macca was commentating from there. And then the graphics were produced. So all the overlays of timing and splits and all that kind of stuff was coming out of Singapore live. And again, all feeding into London and then London up to the interwebs and beyond. Like it's an impressive array of stuff all happening in real time across literally multiple continents to make it all work and in theory stream to you in the most seamless manner possible. And I think they did achieve that. Like I watched the entire production back this morning while I was writing up my post. And yeah, there were some minor blips here and there and some minor delays by a second or two because of the commentators being so far away. But it was fine. Like it was a very watchable, very enjoyable experience, I would actually argue. Like it was really well done overall for the first one they've done this, to have it all indoors. They've done Super League Triathlon in the past outdoors, but that's when all the groups are in one spot and able to coordinate seamlessly, and they've done it numerous times over the years. Finally, you may be asking yourself, how does this make money? This looks like it would cost a lot of money. That was my first impressions walking into this. I'm looking at it going, someone's losing a lot of money here today. And indeed, they were losing, quote, a reasonable amount of money is the exact quote. Says, the event will lose a reasonable amount of money is the exact quote I got when I asked them about this. And a reasonable, I think, probably varies between me and you. Like if you ask me how much money that lost, I would be like, oh, damn. But they've got investment backers in the same way that Zwift has investment backers. And Zwift, by that same definition, probably loses a much bigger reasonable amount of money each year because they're not profitable either yet. And their goal in terms of the Super League Triathlon is as a spectator sport, more in person than actually broadcast. So their money comes from kind of a couple different piles. One is that there's host city fees. So a city like Rotterdam pays organizations to host the event there and in theory brings in more revenue through hotels and things like that to cover that. Number two, there are sponsorships. So in the case you saw Tacx sponsoring it, a couple other sponsors that I've unfortunately already forgotten. And then three, there's corporate hospitality presences and kind of that entire like wine and dine experience that you sometimes see at, you know, tennis tournaments and golf and things like that, where corporations can buy basically a glorified booth that, you know, they can bring in their guests to and watch the whole thing go down as they give them fancy food and stuff like that. So those are their main revenue stream. And then there's also the broadcasting revenue as well. But they said that was pretty small in the grand scheme of things for how much this whole thing kind of costs. So, you know, whether or not they'll be able to make a viable business model out of this long term, it remains to be seen. But they've been around a few years. Like this isn't new. The indoor piece is 100% new here. But the actual Super League Triathlon side of it isn't new. And they said it was definitely a very different dynamic between doing it indoors versus like the loud cheering aspect of an outdoor venue that you would have had in years past. But with COVID restrictions and whatnot, there like was no cheering allowed inside this venue. You could clap, but there was no screaming or yelling or anything like that. So anyways, it was cool to go see. Like I enjoyed going and checking it out and seeing all the things running behind the scenes. That was kind of fun. And it was also really good on TV. Obviously, I'm not paid to say any of this or anything like that. I just went down. I spent my own money to get down there to watch it, my own money to get back, my own money to stop at Starbucks along the way and get a sandwich. So I just enjoyed the day checking out triathlon. Hopefully you found this interesting. If so, go ahead and whack that like button at the bottom there or hit the subscribe button. There is plenty more sports technology stuff coming up over the next few days. Like legit, tomorrow, gonna be crazy, folks. Just tossing out there. It's going to be a busy few days. Hopefully I'll be able to fit all the things I hope to fit into tomorrow. They don't spill off the following days, but hold on to your somethings tomorrow. Have a good one.